This is our 12th lecture. We have one more lecture or meeting for the lecture, which is next week. And then we have the final exam the week after that, which is the 14th week of the classes. Before I start my today's lecture, I would like to make some announcement. Number one is that I have extended the deadline of the third project to last day of the semester. Because the reason that I did that is for next week we have another homework that I have added, and I didn't want the project and homework to overlap. So if you go to the assignments, I have added a new assignment, assignment number 8, which is related to the lecture that I will deliver today. And if you go to your projects, I have reloaded project number 3, and in there what I have done is that I have basically extended the deadline to April 30th, which is the last day of this semester. So these are two of the announcements in here. Then if we come to the course documents, in course documents I have started a new part. I call it part 4, which is the last part of our lectures. This part is entitled Broadband and Ad Hoc Networks. It will contain two lectures, lecture number 9, which is about IEEE 802.11 and other wireless LANs, a little bit about HyperLAN 2 and 802.11. And then lecture 10 is about IEEE 802.15, which is personal area networks. Basically, that lecture is a summary of Bluetooth and ultra-wideband technologies. We may have a little bit of interference in that lecture as well, interference between Bluetooth and 802.11. And these are the last two lectures that we will cover in this course. If you go to that particular file, I have the today's lecture in here. I have called it revised version because what I distributed in the class last week is now modified. It's a little bit more extensive. In addition to that, I have added the so-called supporting reading material. This supporting reading material really are extra material that you can read. It's not necessary to read them. The first one is a lecture about Ethernet, which is an overview of Ethernet technology. I took that lecture from EE506, which is Introduction to LANs and WANs, when I used to teach it. I just picked up some slide and put it in there just as a review for those of you who don't remember Ethernet as good as before. Also, I have two additional lectures in there. One is Quality of Service for Wireless LANs, which is 802.11e, and the other one is Wireless LAN New Architectures, which is material in a white paper provided by a company called LXE, which is one of the few companies recently working on next generation wireless LANs. As I said, the reading related to this material are not compulsory. I just left it for you when you finish the course. At least you have some list of complete references if you want to go back and get into material which are also important, but I could not cover. With that, I think I have made all my announcements. And the last announcement that we knew that before is the exam is on the 28th. With that introduction, I would like to start the lecture for today. The lecture is computer has hanged up. Thank you. seems that the network is gone. That's interesting. Seems that the network is disconnected. Aren't we lucky? Oh, okay, network is back. So we have this lecture number 9. Which is wireless LANs. Let me just bring it out so that it is available all the time. Okay. Something fishy today. Something fishy with the computer today. Okay, this lecture is lecture number 9, and lecture number 9 is entitled 802.11 and wireless LANs. As I said a little bit before, this is basically 802.11 with a couple of slides relating to HyperLAN 2. The structure of this particular lecture, before I started, I would like to talk about what we have done before. We talked about mobile data networks in the second half of the course. First, I talked a little bit about wireless MANs, in particular 802.16. I spent maybe a couple of slides in lecture number 6. Then I talked about wireless WANs, like independent WANs, like ARDIS and Mobitex, which I spent maybe one slide in lecture 6. Then I had like shared wireless WANs like CDPD, which I had maybe 3-4 slides on that. And then I had plenty of like coverage of overlay mobile data services, which was in particular talking about GSM, GPRS, and Edge in lecture 7. And then I was talking about CDMA technology and high data rate systems, which was in lecture 8. So in terms of mobile data networks, we have covered overlay networks, which are basically over TDMA and CDMA networks. And these are the ones that we refer to as wide area networks. And really, they are mobile data networks. The other part of, if you look at the wireless WANs, wireless MANs are not mobile. They are basically fixed to multipoint services. The second part of mobile data networks means data networks which are mobile. I usually refer to that as broadband ad hoc networks, which are mobile local networks, basically WLANs and WPANs. And a standardization organization is 802.11 and 802.15. 802.11, we will cover it in this current lecture. 802.15, we will cover it in the 10th lecture, which is provided next week. Now, the difference between wide area networks and local area networks in surface is the fact that wide area networks are supposed to provide a comprehensive coverage over a nationwide or international coverage. But broadband and ad hoc networks are supposedly providing coverage which are local and spottish, like hot spots. But another major difference between WANs and WLANs is that WLANs are operating in unlicensed bands, and WANs are operating in licensed bands. As a result, broadband ad hoc network, not only they provide higher data rates, they don't need the expensive cost of license operations. And that's one of the features that has made them attractive. Since they are inexpensive, today there are a bunch of hotspot providers around in the world, but actually governments are stepping in to provide mobile data services free. And samples of that in several cities around the world are available, leading cities in this technology. So this broadband ad hoc networks, not only they are different technologies to provide higher data rates, they are revolutionizing the method that we access to the wireless networks. And the prediction of future of this thing in particular is very vague. I have actually one PhD student which is working in social science department trying to analyze the behavior of this private versus free access for wireless LANs and impact of that on wireless data networks. Other wireless data networks. So if you have like government free broadband access to local area networks, what is the incentive to provide lower data rates? And in general, what is the impact of these two to one another? That's a very, very hot topic, actually, very important issue. So with that one, I would like to start our technical coverage of broadband ad hoc network, in particular 802.11, which is the subject of this particular lecture. Basically, just to remind you from the first lecture or first lecture, I believe, generally IEEE 802 standards are developed by IEEE Computer Society, under IEEE Communication Society, and the general format is that they have like logical link control, which is supposed to be shared with everybody, all the standards. Then they have bridges, which are again governing all the standards. Then we have separate standards like 802.3, which is Ethernet, 802.11, which is wireless LAN, 802.15, which is WPAN. But all of these sub-standards, each of them are one set of MAC and one set of physical layers. So each of these standardization activities in a IEEE community, they are identified with a MAC and a bunch of physical layers. In addition to that, we have management, security, and the reference architecture, which are material which similar to logical link control and bridging covers everybody. So with that introduction, I would like to go to 802.15. But if I do 802.11, before I go to 802.11, I would like to say that 802.11 is nothing but wireless Ethernet. And Ethernet is 802.3. I have covered 802.3 in the other courses, which is in WPI was EE506. In Finland, I had covered that in the local area network course. So just to provide like a review of that, I have left a set of PowerPoint presentations in the website. So you can, if you want to refresh your mind, you can go there. But in general, the only thing that I would like to say about 802.3 before I go to 802.11 is that 802.3 is much simpler version of 802.11. In 802.3, we have carrier sense multiple access with collision detection and with exponential backoff algorithm as the carrier sense multiple access or medium access control. For physical layer, basic Manchester coding was the original one, and then they have changed the Manchester coding to several other techniques, which are basically baseband type of coding, and summary of those things are available in the website for you. So basically, one more important issue related to 802.3 is that 802.3 has only one packet format, and that packet format has source and destination address plus the data and some codes at the end. It's a very simple packet format. Basically, all of these type of networks, like IEEE networks or 802.3 or 802.11, the way that they differentiate them from voice-oriented network, like, for example, GPRS or, I mean, GSM or IS-95, the basic thing is that in here I'm talking about packet communication. So I have a connection-less environment, means that every packet carries the information about source and destination, and also packet should control, some packet should be around to provide the control. In 802.3 in particular, there's only one packet format for everybody. Okay, and we have seen that before that recently to provide VLAN and full duplex, they have made some modification. They have played some tricks to the existing basic packet of 802.3 so that they can do other things. Other things, what are those other things? Control signaling, if you want. Why do you need control signaling for Ethernet? I need control signaling for Ethernet if I want to have VLAN, for example, if I want to have full duplex operation. So as a result, in here I don't have any like call establishment type of thing. Everything is with simple packet format. So with that introduction, let's just go ahead for 802.11. What do I want to say about 802.11? First, I would like to give you an introduction about what is going on and give you the reference model. And when I give you the reference model, I will tell you how it works, how the network works. Do you remember that I was talking about GSM? I told you how it was working. What is the registration, authentication, etc.? That was a connection-based network. Here is very similar to that with some modification. Modification is that in here everything is much simpler. So that would be the first part. Then the second part is detail of the MAC layer and the detail of physical layer. For the MAC layer, 802.11 has three mechanisms. I will go over that. And then for physical layer, there is like six options, three traditional ones and three new ones. And I will go over those six physical layers. Then at the end of this, also I will give you a couple of slides which compares HyperLAN 2, MAC, and performance with the performance of 802.11a. And also, what is the difference between them? But that's only a couple of slides. And I finish my lecture with performance analysis of wireless LANs in general. If you remember, I had talked about performance analysis of wide area networks. We were taking like statistics of signal-to-noise ratio, statistics of the data rate, and we were calculating the average probability of error. In here, I will talk about performance evaluation, the way that is applied to wireless LANs, which is slightly different from the way that performance evaluation is applied to wide area networks and also wired local area networks. So that's the last part of this lecture. So basically, I go over overview and reference model, how it works, MAC layers, physical layer alternatives, and how people evaluate the performance of wireless LAN, and how does it differ from the performance of other LANs and wireless WANs. Okay? That's the total lecture that I would like to cover. With that, I start with, I told you, unlicensed bands. This is the summary of unlicensed band. Basically, in the United States, we have two unlicensed bands. The first one, ISM bands, which were released in 1985. The second one is UNII bands, Unlicensed National Information Infrastructure, Instrumentation, Scientific, Medicine. That's the names of, I mean, acronym. But in fact, this one is three bands, one of them at 900, one of them at 2.4, and one of them at 5.7. These bands are all at 5 gigahertz, different segments of 5 gigahertz. Basically, all the successful WLANs and Bluetooth are operating in 2.4 gigahertz. So the dominant unlicensed band today is 2.4 gigahertz. In addition to that, another unlicensed band has emerged with FCC, which is for ultra-wideband, which is between 3.1 gigahertz up to 1.6 gigahertz. That's only for ultra-wideband operation, and that is the one which is related to 802.15, which is WPANs. And we will study that in the next lecture. So most of the successful things that we have are around 2.4, but originally wireless LAN started in 900, and then 802.11a and Hyperland 2 are operating in 5 GHz, 802.11g and 802.11b, which are the most successful today, are at 2.4 GHz. Now, similar to like Ethernet, for example, after the success of Ethernet, that was 802.3, we had 802.3a, b, c, and went actually out of letters, and they started with like AB, AC, AD. So there are lots of addendums to successful standards. The same way, when 802.11 became successful, a lot of addendums came too. So in addition to 802.11, for example, 8, which was the first addendum, which was trying to have wireless LAN physical layers and MAC layers at a physical layer at 5 GHz. Then we had this 802.11b, which was higher speed physical layer at 2.4. And then we had on top of that C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, and it continues. The latest one, I believe, is 802.11x. Okay. Variety of these things, they have different charters. And if you go to the IEEE 802.11 standardization website, you have the definition of all those charters. I have put just the definition of a bunch of famous ones in here. The most important issues today in the wireless LAN industry, one is to go to higher data rates, which is 802.11n. This is one of the most popular one. The other one is to try to provide quality of service, which is 802.11e. And then there is enhancement in the security, which is 802.11i. So variety, I have put some lectures in the supporting material related to the E. And then outside of 802.11 standard activities, 802.11 standard, there are new companies which are working to enhance the infrastructure for wireless LANs. And I have left one more paper related to that in your reading list. So with that introduction, let's go and look into the 802.11. 802.11 reference model, I believe we saw that in the first lecture. Basically, we have some access points and we have some mobile terminals. If I have access point connected to a backbone local area network and mobile terminals communicate with access point, it's called infrastructure. And if I have like two laptops talking with one another, it's called ad hoc. So these are the two terminologies that evolved actually very early, around 1988, in the wireless LAN industry, because the first wireless LANs which were produced or manufactured were doing these two different type. We had two type of solution at that time. Today, the dominant wireless LANs are the infrastructure one. Among the dominant applications for wireless LAN today, one is the hotspot, the other one is corporate wireless LAN, the other one is wireless LAN for home networking. All three of them are infrastructure. The reason that they are infrastructured, because anyway, when you have a wireless LAN, you want to connect to internet. That's the dominant application. If you don't have infrastructure facade, how can you communicate with internet? But in the early days, when the wireless LANs came to the market, nobody was thinking about internet. Internet was not yet invented. I mean, it was not yet popular. Okay, so we are talking about mid-1980s and late 1980s. At that time, this ad hoc networking was very, very important because people were thinking about a lot of applications like that. Now, implementation of 802.11 in practice, infrastructure one, is fairly simple. You have a backbone, which is like Ethernet. That's the dominant one. Then you have access point connected to that. And then you have mobile terminal. Your mobile terminal has MAC and physical layer of 802.11. Then your access point acts like a bridge. What it does, it reads the MAC and physical layer of the 802.11, translate them to 802.3, and puts them in the backbone network. And the backbone network operates with physical and MAC layer of 802.3. So this is a typical implementation of 802.11. The way that it operates, how does it work? If you remember in like GSM, we always had some broadcast signal, which was coming from what? From the base station for synchronization and for identification of the network. Equivalent to that, in the wireless LAN environment, you have beacon signals. The way that beacon signal is working is it doesn't have any separate channel. In GSM, for example, you have different channels. In CDMA, you have different channels. Means that you have one channel, either a portion of time which is synchronized, or a specific code which is used for synchronization. Okay? And you have a different frequency or a different code for other things. But when you come to the connectionless networks, like wireless LANs, you have one medium which is shared with everybody. So the access point and base station, they are operating in the same frequency, not similar to time division duplexing. But in time division duplexing, you have synchronized places, which you can assign things to that. In here, you don't have any synchronization to assign anything to anything. So now I want to provide a beacon. How can I provide beacon? Beacon, I would rather to be a periodic signal. It comes in here, and then it comes in here, then it comes in here, then it comes in here. So at each of these times, I have a short packet that I want to send. But the same medium is shared between traffic and the signal. Now, what if somebody is sending some packets, long packets? Because in the wireless, in the local area networking industry, you have long packets. Okay, so I have a long packet which is in here, coming from a terminal, and base station or access point wants to send the beacon at this time. What it does, the beacon reads that somebody is in there, waits until the beacon, until the traffic is over, then it sends its own beacon. So basically, beacon is not a periodic signal, is a pseudo-periodic signal, if you want to call it. So whenever there is an opportunity, I can send my beacon. And I prefer to send it periodically. What does this beacon carry? Basically, synchronization signals. I said that there is no synchronization. Why do you need synchronization in here? In here, if you want to implement power control, you need to put everybody in a sleep. So the power control, the way that it's used in the 802.11, is different from the power control in like GSM or IS-95. In GSM IS-95, for power control, you were reducing the transmitted power. In here, what you do, you take advantage of a sleeping time. Because packets are coming in burst, so you basically put the terminal in a sleeping mode. Whenever there is some data for that particular terminal, the terminal is sleeping and wakes up, reads, talks with the access point. If there is some data, reads the data. Okay, and then goes to the sleep. This way, you are going to save a lot of battery time because you have very long periods of idle time with very short periods which are associated to what? Packet transition. So this is like power control. Now, how do you measure the, and you can also control the power based on the distance. Now, if you want to measure the power, receive signal strength, how do you want to measure receive signal strength? I measure the receive signal using the beacon. Why do you need to measure the receive signal strength? Because if I want to do handoff, if I'm just walking and I'm associated to one access point and I want to go to another access point, I want to know that what is the receive power. When the receive power goes below certain level, I try to look for other solutions. Okay? So how do I measure the receive signal strength? I use the beacon. The next thing is that when I turn my laptop on, laptop listens for the beacon. When it listens to the beacon, wants to find the ID number of the network, SSID, okay, which is the ID of the network. When you match with that ID, you connect to that particular network. Okay, so these are who is assigning, who is giving or announcing that nom, again, is the beacon. So beacon basically is used for providing timing signals, providing measures of the power for the handoff, and also to provide general information to everybody of any kind. That's the beacon signal. Second issue is that issue of association. What is association? Association is very similar to registration. If you remember for the like GSM, when you turn on the terminal, it starts to do the registration process, which was a long process. In here, association is a very short process. But you have to transfer some information between the access point and mobile station to associate yourself to that particular access point. Now, when you do the association, the next step is that you want to reassociate yourself to another access point. This is the time that you want to go for roaming from one access point to another access point. If you want to go from one access point to another, you need two mechanisms. One is reassociation. The other one is dissociation. Means that I want to go away from the access point and I want to connect myself to the next access point. So basically, I have three mechanisms in here. Association, reassociation, and dissociation. These are the things that I use for implementation of handoff. The handoff procedure in 802.11 is given in here. I have like this base station already associated to this access point. And the base station is moving toward the other base. I have this mobile terminal. And it's moving toward in this direction. As it comes to these areas, the receive signal strength from this access point becomes weak. When the receive signal strength becomes weak, this particular terminal starts to first read other beacons passively to see that what is the, if there is any other access point with a stronger signal. If it cannot find it, it sends a probe signal to all the surrounding access points. The probe signal goes to any access point. In response to that probe comes some response. And based on that response, this guy measures a set of power for different access points. And then it picks up the access point with the strongest signal. So when it picks up the access point with the strongest signal, it associates itself, at that time it's in here, associates itself to that particular, and reassociate itself with there, and at the same time, it dissociates itself from the previous access point. Okay? So these are the mechanisms. Through association, reassociation, dissociation, you can do the handoff between two access points. But now these two access points have to talk with one another to say that if there is additional information to be passed on. That communication between the access point was not originally standardized in 802.11. So a group called IOP, they came together and they devised like a source of mechanism for providing this communication between the access points. And that's more or less the entire story in here. So IEEE original standard, 802.11, was reassociation and reassociation response between the new access point and old access point and mobile station. And then between the access point new and old access point, there is a mechanism which is just sending a simple packet of handover request to the other one and handover respond in there. But this one was not originally in 802.11. It was developed by IEOP group. And now it is getting to be a standard under 802.11. So basically, these are just mobility management, if you want to say. Very simple, with three instructions, actually. Now, power management, I already told you. Power management in here is based on what? Based on a sleeping mode. Authentication. Basically, you have three types of authentication in here. Number one is that when you want to associate yourself with the network, you should know the SSID of the network. But that one does not provide adequate amount of amount of security because you can read it basically very simply through the packets. There are other provisions. One of them is like just sending a, they call it the open system. In there, you just send a request and you receive an answer and then you do the association. The other one is the so-called shared key authentication, which you can use. For shared key authentication, operation is very similar to like the one that you had in GSM. You have like a common key, which is held between the base station and the mobile, and then they communicate based on that. The detail of that is in here, and the description is in the book. So basically, up to here, what I told you is that in terms of mobility management, like registration and handoff and power control, 802.11 has very, very simple versions of, let's say, GSM. The major difference between like 802.11 and, let's say, GSM or CDMA systems is that in here, you have only one channel that everybody shares. So you don't have this so-called radio resource management. So as a result, everything is very simple. Okay? On the other hand, these wireless LANs were designed for what? They were designed for very simple operation. I have one access point, and everybody wants to communicate with that access point. As the time passed by, and these became more popular, people want to provide comprehensive coverage. Then the architecture of existing 802.11 is not adequate. So there are a bunch of companies like LXE, which I have some papers related to that in your website, which are trying to expand this. How do they want to expand it? The way that it is today, you have like a corporate network and you have a bunch of access points. Basically, you have defined some sort of like interfaces between the client and between the access points, two, and then between the access point and the host, four of them. And then you have your network, corporate network. Now, as the time is going on now, they want to take these access points, and on top of the access point, they put a sort of like base station controller. Do you remember base station controllers in GSM? In GSM, for any access point, if you want to say, for any base station, you had like a base station controller. Behind the base station controller, you had what? You had a switch, the same structure in here. You will have a wireless switch, and then you have these base station controllers, which could be in a hierarchy. What is the purpose of these guys? What are they doing? What they do is that they do that frequency management, if you want to say. Okay? And frequency management in here much more complex, because in cellular environment, these access points are very, very expensive. So when you install one of them, the other one is going to be far away. Okay? Now, what they do in the wireless LANs, the story is not like that. I have like 5 students in this class, I put one access point. And then it's not adequate, I put another access point to increase the throughput. So this base station controller type of thing that I have, or management people which are at the in the back, they come and they take the other existing frequencies, they distribute it among the access points. Okay? And at the same time, they try to provide maximum throughput to the users and possibly provide them with quality of service based on the need that they have. And also they provide another interface between these guys and switches, which are the wireless switches next hierarchy, which is just like mobile switching center. Why do I need these wireless switches? The same as mobile switching center. If somebody is moving from one part of the network to another part of the network, and I want him to be connected with authentication, I have to somehow control it through a central thing, and that's this wireless network. So this is very similar to the architecture of what? Of any cellular system. But this time, this is for what? For connectionless networks. While for cellulars, I had that infrastructure for connection-based networks. Now, so if you count in terms of interfaces, earlier I had like only between these two and between this guy and the host. Now I have to define a bunch of new interfaces. Okay? Do you remember, like for GSM, I had or for North American standard. I had IS 634, for example, for communication between base stations. I had communication between base station controllers and the mobile switching center. Then I had IS 41 between mobile switching centers. Similarly, in here, you have to develop further additional standards, which are today are emerging. First, technologies is coming, and why it was not there before? Because there was no market for wireless LANs. Why there is a need for that now? Because market is evolving, and even governments are considering providing large, huge nationwide coverage, or at least city-wide coverage of wireless LANs. And if you want to control network like that, you need this type of thing. Okay, so that's the direction of the thing. Now, up to here, what I told you was the direction of the wireless LAN industry. Now, and 802.11 in particular, what I would like now to continue is just to talk about the technical details. What is the technical details of 802.11? Basically, I have two things. One is MAC, and the other one is what? Physical layer. How many MACs do I have for 802.11? We discussed that perhaps in lecture number 3. We have basic operation, which is carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance. Then we have request to send, clear to send. And then we have a third mechanism, which we call it point coordination function. What is carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance? Basically, I have this data. As soon as I have data, nobody is in the air, I will send it. Other people, when I'm in the air, they don't send anything. When I'm finished, they have 3 time slots to wait. And this is based on the priority that they have. One time slot is the short interframe spacing, which is SIF. The other one is point coordination interframing space, which is PIFS, and the other one is the data interframe spacing, which is DIF. So what will happen is that I have 3 type of priorities, really. When a packet is finished, either I can send after the SIF, or I can send after the PIF, or I can send after the DIF. How do they apply that? Who is using SIF? For example, if I have acknowledgement, acknowledgement is high priority, a very short packet with high priority. After the data is finished, I wait very short period, I send my data. What is PIF? PIF is for voice, for point coordination function, which is for voice application. I will tell you how it works. And what is DIF? DIF is for the rest of the data. Okay? So basically, I have, at the end of each packet, people wait either for SIF or PIF or for DIF, and then they send the data. I had an example. So basically, I have these 3 operation: carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance, which was the basic one that I told you in here. This guy can work with acknowledgement and can work without acknowledgement. Normally, it works with the acknowledgement, but if you want to have multicast, it operates without acknowledgement. Now, you have another mechanism, request to send, clear to send. This mechanism is developed for hidden terminals. And then you have this optional point coordination function, which is used for time-bounded packets, basically used for voice or video if you want. Now, the MAC of 802.11, in addition to these 3 mechanisms, provides an environment for independent and infrastructure configuration. Means that if I have 2 wireless LANs talking with each other, or they want to communicate through an access point, the detail is provided. Fragmentation and reassembly. Because you have multiple physical layers, you have different length requirements. So those different length requirements are provided with the MAC feature, as a MAC feature. Roaming support between different access points using association, dissociation, and reassociation. Power management with a sleeping option, which I told you. Authentication and privacy, which I went over that. So the MAC features of 802.11 are as identified in here. I already talked about these details in some length that I wanted to go over. Now I get back to the Mac and I talk about different Macs. Basically, carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance best is described with this example, which I think I went over that in lecture number 3. I quickly go over that once more. I have a bunch of stations, A, B, C, D, and they want to access to the channel. First, A, there was nobody in the air, sends its own frame. Others, like B and C and D, they want to send during the transmission of here. They check, this guy is busy, they wait. Everybody waits up to the end. When it's finished, they work for inter-frame spacing, which in here is defs. And after that, each of them, they run a random number generator to come up with a random number for retransmission. And these random numbers are different. For example, B comes up with a number which is that length, C comes with a number which is that length, D comes with a number which is this length. Right after inter-frame spacing, all three start to run their clocks. The first one, which finishes its clock, is C. As soon as it finishes clock, it sends the frame. When the frame is sent, others hear the frame is sent, they freeze their clocks. When they freeze their clock, they wait until this frame is finished. At the end, they rerun their clocks, the leftover of their clock. The one which finishes first sends the frame. And this procedure continues. Do you remember what was the advantage of this technique over Ethernet, carrier sense multiple access with collision detection? No, well, that's one, but one of the major advantages in here is that this guy is first in, first serve. But carrier sense multiple access with collision detection is first in, last serve, which was caused by what? By exponential backoff algorithm that they had. So that was the first mechanism, carrier sense multiple. They call it carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance rather than collision detection, because this counter mechanism and time interval in between, they really allow you to avoid collision. They are devised to avoid collision. But it cannot avoid the collision 100%. It reduces it significantly. Now, the second mechanism that they have is this, the so-called request to send, clear to send. But before we go there, basically what will happen is that if I have like a data, I will send my data, and then I always send the data after diff, which if you remember, diff was the longest in the frame spacing. When the data is finished, if I need an acknowledgement, I will wait for SIFS, which is the shortest acknowledgement. And then I send my packet in here. Always diff is much bigger than SIF, so as a result, acknowledgement always has higher priority. This is how mobile station and access point, they communicate. The next issue, so this is like issue of carrier sensing. How do you sense the carrier? If you remember, in the Ethernet, sensing the carrier is very simple. Actually, the original thing, because you have just baseband signal with certain amount of voltage, like maybe 15 volt. If the signal level goes above the 15 volt, you know that there is a collision. If there is something, some voltage in there, you know that there is somebody on the wire. But in the wireless environment, it's a little bit more challenging. Now you need to somehow read that somebody is in the air at certain frequency. There are two ways to do that. One is that you just read the carrier directly. So you put a filter. If a signal goes through the filter, it says that there is some signal. The other one is that you detect the signal and you detect the bits. And if you have a few early bits, you say, okay, now channel is. The second one is more robust. The first one makes more error. So these are details that you can do. So you can sense the channel. There are two types of, in fact, carrier sensing provided in 802.11. One of them is physical, which could be either sensing the carrier or sensing the detected bits. The other one is the so-called virtual. For virtual, the 802.11 allows you a mechanism so that you stop everybody from transmission. So you send a signal to everybody, say you everybody stops in the network. And then you do your own transmission. Why do you need that type of transmission? If I have request to send, clear to send, for example. Request to send, clear to send was a mechanism that we devised for hidden terminals. So when I have a terminal in a corner and everybody else is close to the base state or access point, that particular terminal that cannot communicate. It can send a request to send and then followed by an acknowledgement. During that process, a signal gets broadcasted over the network that nobody should operate except that particular terminal. In here, really, I have a virtual carrier sensing mechanism that I'm reporting to everybody that you have sensed the carrier, but they have not sensed the carrier, really. But I will stop them from transmission. So this is what they do in there. In request to send, example for request to send and clear to send, I send a request to send signal. At the same time that I send it, the nav signal goes on for everybody in the network. So nobody else is going to be permitted to communicate during this nav period. Now, after my packet is completed, after a short period, which is SIF, I send clear to send, which is an acknowledgement to request to send. Then after a SIF, the terminal sends the data. After another SIF, it sends the acknowledgement. When this acknowledgement goes through, the nav signal is finished. And now everybody is back into carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance. Okay, so this is how this mechanism. This mechanism is very, very actually helpful, and people are using that for reducing as a mechanism to reduce the interference of Bluetooth, for example, into 802.11 to make coexistence between Bluetooth and 802.11 possible. One of the mechanisms which are used is this thing. Now, the next mechanism, or the third mechanism, is the so-called point coordination function. Point coordination function basically is on top of the carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance. So regular carrier sense multiple access, the packets come in here. In here, when the packets are coming, these packets are contention-free packets. And I put it over a mechanism called point coordination function, which works over CSMACA. And then I go to the physical layer and I send it. How does it work? This is how it works. Basically, point coordination function is organized with the access point. What access point does is reinforce a time clock. So at basic periods like this one and this one, like periodically I have this desire to send bursts. And these are the length of the burst. This one is one burst is in here. This burst could be typical data, voice. Voice is like continual at the same rate, it's not bursty. So I send one piece in here, the other piece in here. Now, similar to beacon, do you remember in the beacon I had the pseudo periodic? In here I have pseudo periodic operation as well. Means that in desirable situation, I have this packet which I'm sending, and when I'm sending that packet, I will establish nav. Do you know why I established the nav? Because I'm stopping everybody except the desirable terminal to communicate. So everybody stops during this period, and I send my particular packet of this length, and when it's finished, I make the medium available for everybody else. Medium is available for everybody else. Somebody senses the channel, there is nothing there, that somebody sends a packet. If this packet finishes before this period, I send my signal in there. But if it passes through that time, I will wait for this guy to finish, and then after that, I send my signal. But the distance between two is a SIF. Okay? So basically what I'm doing is that I'm sending my packets periodically. But if it happens that somebody else between those periodic transmissions is using the channel, I wait for that packet to go through. I wait a SIF, which is highest priority, and I send my packet again. So I have a pseudo periodic transmission of the packet. But this one is coordinated with who? It's coordinated with the access point. But when I had request to send, clear to send, it was coordinated by what? Or initiated by what? By the terminal. Could be initiated by the access point as well. But this one is organized by the access point. So this is the third mechanism. Who is interested in point coordination function? At the beginning, nobody was interested in point coordination function, really. So the first generation of 802.11, PCMCI cards, nobody implements PCF. It's optional and nobody uses it. But as the time passes by, now people are talking about quality of service. When you want to have quality of service, you want to somehow provide priority to time-sensitive type of operation. So what you do, not only you have the point coordination function, you try to add more SIFs and DIFs in between to somehow have hold of implementation of quality of service. Who is doing that? That's 802.11e. So I have something related to that, actually, if you're interested to read in the supporting material. So in particular, that particular subcommittee is looking into integrate this PCF with multiple more number of interframe spacing to support quality of service. Okay? That's what it is. Now, frame format. If you remember, frame format for 802.11, for 802.3 had like preamble, and then it had two addresses. One address for the transmitted, one address for receiver, and then was length of the, well, maybe I better either to put it in here. So it was like something like preamble, and then a starting delimiter, and then I had length of the packet, then I had the data, length of data actually, and then I had data, and then I had this is padding, pad, and then I had error correcting codes. So this was 802.3. Sorry, in here, in between, in here, I had source address, destination address field. Two more fields in there. So basically, I had preamble, a starting delimiter, source address, destination address, length of the packet, the information itself, paths, and error correcting codes. Okay, that was 802.3 original. Okay, very simple packet. Now, when you come to 802.11, the preamble goes to the so-called physical convergence layer that we will see that a little bit later. This is a tag that we will add it later on at the physical layer. So that's in the physical convergence layer, which comes a little bit later. So I don't have preamble in here. Okay. Now, a starting delimiter, I don't have it. It is in there. Now, I start in here with frame control. Frame control, I didn't have it in 802.3 because in 802.3, I had only one type of packet. In here, frame control is an instruction, really, to provide things like what? Association, resociation, dissociation, authentication requests, etc. These are things that I didn't have in 802.3. But since I have a wireless network, I need to implement them. Where do you want to implement it? I have only one type of packet. This is the type of packet. At the beginning, I put that. Then I have duration and ID, which is fine. Very similar to 802.3. Then I have 1, 2, four addressing. Why I have four addresses? In 802.3, I had source address, destination address. In 802.11, I have source address, destination address, and possibly the address of access points associated to the transmitter, access point associated to receiver. So worst to worst, I have four addresses. Okay? In best condition, I have like perhaps like three addresses. One access point, source and destination. Okay? Now, in addition to that, in here I have a sequence control. Why sequence control? I told you fragmentation and reassembly is done at the MAC. So in here you need like to have a sequence number in there. Then frame body and then the code. So in a sense it still remains very similar to the word to 802.3. In particular the addressing are the same addresses, the same MAC addresses that you had before. But what has happened, which is really new, is this frame control. Okay? And these are like typical packets, short packets. This is request to send, clear to send, acknowledgement, and this control frame is expressed in here. This control frame has protocol version at the beginning. Then you have these two important things, subtype and type. These are really 2 bits in here and 4 bits in here, which are going to define different instructions or different packets for control. So I have 2 bits of type, means I have 4 types of control signals. Each of those 4 types has up to what? 4 bits, means 16 type of instruction. So I have 4 times 16, which is what? 64 different possibilities for instructions. What are those instructions really? Do you remember any of them? Instructions for request for association, response for association, request for dissociation, response, authentication, etc. Power control signals. Okay, all of them are in here. Then I have a bunch of other bits in here which are providing like more details in there. Okay, like if the packet goes to destination or comes from destination, there are more fragments coming or not. Is it a retry? Does it have power management? Is more data coming? Wire equivalent privacy is there or not? And this particular bit is reserved for the future. So these are the 16 bits which are used in the frame control. And with these 16, now I can do a lot of things. If you remember in 802.3, in order to implement this type of instructions, people were using what? People were using this length of the data. And they were using numbers, which was more than length of the data, to provide control signals. In here, the mechanism is already embedded. Okay? So that's about the frame of the 802.3. Now, what are the important thing in there? Important thing are these 2 bits, which are dividing the class, and 14 bits, which is type of operation in the class. The 2 bits are differentiating management frame, control frame, data frame, and the last one is unspecified, reserved. Okay? Then the 4 bits. The 4 bits define different management frames or different control frame or different data frames. Now, these are some examples, for example. For management type, if I have the first 2 bits 00, then the next 4 bits, for example, if it's dissociation, is 1010. If it is beacon, it is 1000. And I didn't put the codes for these guys. I didn't put codes for this guy. Authentication, deauthentication. These are the 4 bits associated to that. If you go to control type, the 2 bits are 01. If it is request to send, clear to send, is 1011, 1100. Its acknowledgement is 1101, etc., etc. And then, how about data type? I have data type, variety of data types. And for those, I'm having different like codes in there. Okay, so this is basically how they encode this 16 bits to define management type, control type, and data types. Okay, so that was about basically about medium access control. So that's the medium access control of 802.11. Three type of mechanisms: carrier-sense multiple access with collision avoidance, request to send, clear to send, point coordination function. In addition to that, I told you that how the network works really, which means that how you do the association, dissociation, and implement the handoffs, registration and handoff, and authentication. I told you about that a little bit earlier. I'm done with everything related to the system. Now the more difficult part really is physical layer. There are a variety of physical layers which are used in 802.11. Original 802.11 came with three type of solution: frequency hopping spread spectrum, direct sequence spread spectrum, and infrared. What was the reason? They started 802.11 or wireless LAN standardization activity started around 1988. It completed in 1997. At that time in the industry, they didn't know which technology is going to prevail. And they didn't know even how to standardize this type of thing. Okay? Throughout this period of 10 years, three companies really were leading in there. One of them was NCR, which designed the first direct sequence spread spectrum, and that one really became de facto standard at a different frequency for the physical layer, for direct sequence spread spectrum. The other one was Proxim, possibly, which was using frequency hopping spread spectrum. And then we had a bunch of companies which appeared and disappeared because market was not evolving. The problem was not the standard. Problem was the market for 802.11. So another companies which were appearing and disappearing were infrared companies. At the beginning, they had this company called Photonic, which was supported by Apple Computer. And they were supported of diffuse infrared. Later on, another company called Spectrix tried to carry the flag for diffuse infrared. By the time that the standard was completed, 1997, none of these were really useful because people were already talking about 11 megabit per second at least, or 10 megabit per second products, which very shortly after 802.11, they became finalized. I mean, 1997, I had the original 802.11. 1998 was 802.11b. Now, how come B is earlier than A? You expect that A becomes first, B. 802.11a really initiated the work because of HyperLAN. HyperLAN 1 standard in the Europe started around 1992. But nobody committed themselves to develop any product. So for the second phase, which was HyperLAN 2, they tried to associate themselves with 802.11, which already had a market, and it was growing. As a result, but HyperLAN 1 was operating in 5 gigahertz. So they came and they tried to merge to 802.11a, which is the first physical layer other than the three traditional ones. But shortly after that, another group came at the 2.4 gigahertz to provide the data rate for 802.11b now. Okay? But a standardization for A, which is at 5 gigahertz, implementation and standard took longer. So A came to market later because the technology at 5 gigahertz was more difficult for design of the modems. Okay, and by the time that 802.11 comes to the market, A comes to the market, B had already captured the market. On the other hand, 802.11a is operating at 5 gigahertz, coverage is not as good. What was the technology for that? For 802.11, technology was OFDM. Okay, But since coverage was not good, they couldn't provide it at 5 gigahertz. So they started to think about taking that OFDM and come to what? To 2.4 gigahertz, which has better coverage. That was 802.11g. Now, this 802.11g has to be backward compatible to the B. B has to be backward compatible to original 802.11 because all of them are operating in 2.4 gigahertz. And that was the story of the past few years for the physical layers. So now let's go over these physical layers one by one and see how they operate and how they provide data. In terms of data rate, the original three were how much? Do you remember? 2 megabit per second. 1 and 2 megabit per second. Always for wireless LANs, you have what? Backup data rate. For what reason? Similar to wireless fans. Signal to noise ratio goes lower. I go to simpler modulation. I have bigger coverage, longer coverage. Okay, the same thing. When they started with 802.11, they were not that keen. They had only two data rates, 1 and 2 megabit per second. As time passed by, they realized that this is more important. They came to 802.11b. It goes 11, 5.5, 2, and 1. They come to 802.11a. It goes 54, 36, 27, 12, 18, 12, 9, 6 megabit per second. A bunch of data rates now. Another reason for that is that when you were talking about like original 802.11, modulation techniques were QPSK, binary PSK. As the time passed by, people started to get more complex modulation techniques. In 802.11a, I have 64 QAM, 64 points in the constellation. The same is for G. Okay? Now we want to go over these technologies and see how they evolve. Let's start with frequency hopping. The frequency hopping physical layer for 802.11, the same as frequency hopping for the Bluetooth, they take the 2.4 gigahertz band of ISM band, which is about 84 megahertz bandwidth. And in there, they use 78 channels, each of them 1 megabit per second in terms of symbol rate, and they are apart 1 megahertz from one another. So I have what? 78 channels, both for Bluetooth and what? 802.11 frequency hopping spread spectrum. In 802.11, what they do is that they have divided this in three groups. So first one goes to first group, second to the second, third to the third, then fourth one goes to the first group, fifth one second, so you recycle on that. Okay? So first one, fourth one, and then what? Seventh one, etc. They are going to be first group, second group, third group. And then within all of, and these are non-overlapping groups. Okay? So you can have like one, three access points. Without any collision, they provide 6 megabit per second to you. Okay, to the environment. Okay? Because I have three sets of 26 hops, and they are independent from. How about Bluetooth? Bluetooth is not like that. Bluetooth randomly jumps over the 78 channels. So, Bluetooth is in a sense frequency hopping code division multiple access. Means that people are running in random sequences. I mean, different users. They run at random sequences, so they may hit each other. Okay? But in 802.11, they have three separate random patterns. So nobody hits nobody. Okay? That's the basic difference between the two. But now if I have 802.11 working with Bluetooth, they may hit each other. But the hits are not very substantial because everybody is going randomly. So interference between 802.11 frequency hopping spread spectrum and Bluetooth is not much. Who is using this frequency hopping? Some of these cordless telephones, they use frequency, still they use frequency hopping. So if you have Bluetooth next to them, doesn't make too much problem. When we go to direct sequences spread spectrum, Bluetooth interferes more. Because, we will see that a little bit later, the bandwidth is 26 megahertz. So I have a bandwidth from here to here, and Bluetooth can jump and hit it. The probability of hit is 1/3. In here, probability of hit is 1 over 78. Okay? And when you hit, you kill. That's the assumption. Okay, we talk about that maybe a little bit later. But anyway, this is the frequency hopping pattern of 802.11. Frequency hopping spread spectrum and its comparison with Bluetooth. Okay? So when we go to Bluetooth, we will avoid that one. The next thing is that in here, for the communication, you have the MAC layer, and then you have physical layer convergence protocol. And then you have the physical layer. What is physical layer convergence? Any protocol is only a header. Huh? This is a header. This is the header. Okay? Now, how does it work? From here to here is the header. Physical link convergence protocol. Okay? In here is what? Is my packet data unit from the MAC. So this is MAC layer packet data unit. The length of the MAC layer packet data unit can be up to 4 kilobytes. Okay? Now, they whiten that. Whitening means what? They randomize that. Okay? So the bits which are transmitted are a sort of a scramble. Okay? And then, the total could be at the rate of 1 megabit per second, could be at the rate of 2 megabit per second. If it's 1 megabit per second, they use binary frequency modulation. And if it, binary PSK. And if it is 2 megabit per second, they use QPSK. Okay? Now, how about the header? Header in here has several parts. This header is very similar to the header of 802.3, with the difference that in here I have longer sync period because it's radio. I have the start of the frame delimiter, which is like 16 bits. And then I have packet length in here, 12 bits. Then I have packet signaling field, which is like 4 bits. And then I have CRC. This CRC is like error correcting code, which is only for the header and the preamp, for the header, this information in here. Okay. So what you do in here is that you will synchronize, then you start the information, and then you will say what is the length of the packets. Then you come to PSF. In PSF, you will tell them that what is the data rate of this MAC packet to follow. Okay? Data rate could be what? At that time, it was 1 and 2 megabit per second, but they had like left like 4 bits. So you have, 3 bits of that is used. 3 of these 4 bits is used for data rates. Goes data rates between 1 to 4.5 megabit per second. Each half a megabit per second. So 000 is 1 megabit per second. 001 is 0.5 megabit, 1.5 megabit per second, goes up to 4.5 megabit per second. Okay? The interesting part in here is that I have one header, and all the headers are at 1 megabit per second, at one data rate. So everybody can read that. When they finish the reading the header, then they can change the data rate. And this tradition is followed in all of the packets of 802.11. Always you have a header which tells you what is to expect to follow. Okay? And we didn't have something like that in 802.3. Okay. But they tried to add it later on to that. Okay. So this is more or less like detail of the header in here. Now, how about the physical layer itself? Physical layer itself, I already told you, They have like 79 different carriers, each 1 megahertz. Then they have 4-level or 2-level Gaussian FSK. I told you BPSK, no, Gaussian FSK for 1 and 2 megabit per second. They have 3 groups of channel, each of them 26, which I already told you, okay? Multiple base stations can coexist in the same area. I already told you about it. So you can go up to 6 megabit per second. The hopping rate. The hopping rate, this is a frequency hopping spread spectrum. Means that you jump over different frequencies. Anytime that you jump, you have a rate. The rate in here is 2.5 hops per second. The rate of jumps in Bluetooth is 1600. So Bluetooth is a fast frequency hopping compared with what 802.11. Now, what is the point? When I do the hops, when I do like 1600 hops, I will have 625 microseconds in each hop. So my packet can be maximum 625 bits. That's for Bluetooth. If I do the hops like 2.5 hops per second, my packet length can be much longer than that, which can accommodate up to what? 4 kilobytes of information. So basic difference between Bluetooth and 802.11 now comes into what? Into the formation of the packets, which is related to number of hops that they have. Okay, power maximum is 100 milliwatt. For the Bluetooth, power in the Europe up to 100 milliwatt, in the States up to 1 milliwatt. Okay. So that's about frequency hopping. So when I was describing the frequency hopping, really I described that as in the context of comparing that with Bluetooth, because it's not used that much, to tell you the truth, anymore. I mean, it's just phasing out. Now, but direct sequence spread spectrum, why do I want to talk about that? Because direct sequence spread spectrum is the foundation for 802.11b, which is the most popular today. But other than that, this is not used either. Okay? Now, how does it work? The same. In here, what I have direct sequence spread spectrum. You remember what was direct sequence spread spectrum? Means that I have these data rates. What is my data rate? 1 and 2 megabit per second. Okay? So my baud rate is what? 1 megabaud per second. Now, I have to multiply it with the chips. Means each bit turns to many other bits. How many chips? 11 chips per bit. Means that when I have a bit of data which comes in direct sequence spread spectrum, it's multiplied with what? With 11 of these little chips. And that spreading code which used for this chip is the so-called Barker code. Barker code. We have seen that previously in some of the examples. Okay? But anyways, this is how it works. Now, so I have the packet data unit, which is coming from the MAC layer, has a length of up to 4 kilobyte. But in here, I don't do whitening. Whitening means scrambling. Because when I multiply it with the chips, they get whitened in a sense. Okay, but if it is frequency of spread, I have to spread them. How about the rest of the fields? These rest of the fields are my PLCP, Physical Layer Convergence Protocol. This is the header for physical layer, which is at 1 megabit per second again. Okay, but well, how does it do? It has again a sync, SDF, similar to the other one, a field called signal, which is equivalent to SDF in the other one, which tells you what is the data rate, then the type of service, which is reserved for the future, length of the data, similar to the previous one, and then error controls for the header. So this format is very similar to the format of what PLCP in the frequency hopping version. But numbers are not the same. Why they didn't pick up the same thing? Because they have different modulation technique and different synchronization requirement. Beyond that, these technologies were developed independently with competing companies. And when they got mature, people were trying to make these mature technologies which are selling a standard. As a result, they are somehow in the same framework, but they are not exactly the same thing. For example, in here, I have an extra field for what? For the which is reserved for the future services. But in the PLCP of the frequency hopping spread spectrum, I didn't have it. This has been very subjective when they were designing that, because we had hundreds of different solutions coming, and only two of them prevailed, and they became like the de facto standard. Okay? So, but general concept is the same. All of them, always your preamble, or physical layer convergence protocol stuff, which is your like tag, beginning tag, header, we call it header. That header is always at what data rate? At lowest data rate, which is 1 megabit per second. Okay? Because among everything else, that's the easiest, that's the strongest, least amount of error that I make, okay, to just create it in there. Okay. Now, how about physical layer details? I already told you they have like 11 bit Barker code, 11 chip Barker code, means every bit goes to what? 11 chips. Okay, what is the symbol rate? Symbol rate was how much? 1 megabit per second times 11 is 11 mega chip per second. So the transmission rate that I have is 11 mega chips per second. And that's a very important number. Okay? Because later on, I take this 11 megabit chip per second and I try to build what? 802.11b, for example. Now, how about 2 megabit per second? If I want to go to 2 megabit per second, I go to QPSK. Means 2 bits per symbol. Okay? What is the bandwidth? Bandwidth is 26 megahertz. The bandwidth is very wide, so the design of the filters are very loose and simple. So they are not very accurate system if you want to compare it with GSM, for example. Why? Because in here, bandwidth is not as important. Okay? And also, you want to implement very high data rates with very low cost. Total, they have, like originally they had 5 overlapping bands and 3 non-overlapping bands. Later on, they increased the 5 overlapping bands to 11 or 13 overlapping bands. But the important thing is that there's only 3 non-overlapping, because I have 26 megahertz per each of these guys. 3 26 megahertz is what? Is 78 megahertz, which was the thing that was covering for frequency hopping spread spectrum as well as for direct sequence spread spectrum. Power is 100 milliwatt. And then in terms of interference, since I have 26 megahertz of bandwidth, Bluetooth is going to interfere with this much more than what? Much more than frequency hopping spread spectrum. Okay. Now, if they are very close to one another. So these are the non-overlapping bands, each of them 26 megahertz. And these are the Barker codes. This is the autocorrelation function. This is non-cyclic autocorrelation function. If you calculate the cyclic autocorrelation function, this becomes a straight line. This is non-cyclic autocorrelation function of the Barker code. Now, the next one is diffused infrared. I don't think we have enough of time to go over that, and it's not used that much. But basically what I tell you is that physical layer in here, they are sending pulses at the rate of 4 megabits per second, if you want to call it, 4 mega symbol per second. So what they do is that either they take 4 bits, they pulse position modulate that into 16 bits, which is a rate of what? 4 in watt. So 1 megabit per second times 4 is 4 megabit per second, which is the transmission rate. So basically, you have these little pulses, okay, which are transmitted at the rate of what? At the rate of 4 megabit per second. So I have light pulses, length of these are 250 nanosecond. So the data rate is 1 over that is 4 mega symbol per second or bit per second for the transmit symbol or bit per second. So this is 4 mega symbol per second. Now you add a coding to that, which is the so-called pause position coding. Means that I'm sending a bunch of bits in here. I always send them like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 16 of them. Only one of them is a 1. The rest are all 0. So I have a pulse which comes in one of the 16 slots. That's for 1 megabit per second. For 2 megabit per second, they have like 4 slots. One of them is 1. Okay? So how does it work? This is in here. Now, if you come back in here, generally, the transmission rate, this transmission rate is what? 4 megabit per second, because the pulses are 250 nanosecond. Okay, if I'm using 1 out of 16, means that every 4 bit is encoded to 16 bit. So there's a ratio of 4. So the data is coming at what rate? At 1 megabit per second. It's transmitted at 4 megabit per second. Okay, in here, the data is transmitted at 4 megabit per second, but every 4 bit represents 2 bits of data. So the data is at what rate? 2 megabit per second. As simple as that. Okay, and it has its own header, etc. With that, I would like to now take a pause. And we take like 5 minutes pause, and when we come back, we continue on. Now, A22.11B physical layer, A22.11A, and A22.11G physical layers, and then possibly a little bit of performance related to them. What I did basically in the first part of this lecture, lecture number 9, I gave you the general architecture and implementational issues associated to what? Original A22.11. Then I talked about 3 MAC layers. I talked about 3 basic physical layers which were implemented in the first draft in 1997. When we come back in the next part, I talk about other physical layers and performance evaluation of A22.11.